Hey everyone, Justin Conroy, Financial Dad here. And today I want to talk about the difference between good debt and bad debt, because if you're considering going into debt for some reason, you really need to consider whether or not that debt is going to benefit you or hurt you. There's a lot of debate out there on the topic of whether or not good debt actually exists, but I'm definitely in the camp that debt can be a good thing if you use it properly. But debt in general is a lot like credit cards. If it isn't managed properly, it can be a huge detriment to your personal finance situation. What disappoints me though is the fact that as I began researching for this video, I mostly just found lists online saying that ABC things are good debt and XYZ things are bad debt. But I think it's a lot more nuanced than that. So in this video, I'm going to give you my thoughts on what constitutes as good debt and bad debt, some of the gray areas associated with each, and give you some examples of some situations in which something that might normally be considered bad could actually be good. With that, do me a big favor and smash the like button for the YouTube algorithm. Let's get this started. First, I want to address the fact that all debt has risk. Whether it be good debt or bad debt, anytime you decide to go into debt for something, there's an inherent risk that your financial situation will change and that you might not actually be able to pay off the debt that you take on. This is why guys like Mr. Dave Ramsey back here pretty much tell you that all debt is bad debt. You never know what your future holds, you never know what's going to change in the world, and you never know whether or not the debt you decide to take on today will even be payable tomorrow. Life happens fast and it happens a lot. Hopefully the last 6 months have been a testament to this. The point is, when we start talking about good debt versus bad debt, you should always keep it in your head that all debt has risk and it's best to avoid it, in general, unless you've got a backup plan if something goes wrong in your life. So with that disclaimer out of the way, let's start off by going over some of the basic conceptual ideas of good debt and bad debt, the rules of thumb that will fit most cases. When it comes to good debt, we mainly talk about debt that is being used to buy an asset of some kind, rather than something disposable or some consumer good. So when it comes to what we expect from good debt, we generally talk about number one, debt that increases your income, number two, debt that pays for an asset that appreciates in value, or three, debt that saves you money by freeing up cash for investments. Now, depending on the situation, those can all go hand in hand, but let's unpack them one at a time. First, we have debt that increases your income. This should be pretty obvious, but what we mean here is debt that you take on with the intent or goal of increasing your income in some way. The most obvious purchase with debt that fits that description would be a car. Now, if you've read any articles on this subject, you'd know that a car is generally considered to be bad debt, but I really don't agree with this. I'll get into the math a bit more detail later, but for now, let's focus on the idea that a car can be good debt simply because it can help you generate income. For most people who can't work from home, and depending on the city you live in, a car can be absolutely critical to your ability to hold a normal job. If you're in a situation where you need a car to be able to get back and forth from work, and you're not able to outright pay for one, going into debt for a reasonably priced used car can absolutely be a good thing. Your ability to generate income is critical to your financial success, and if that means you need a car to make that happen, then a car is absolutely a worthwhile investment. Next, we have debt for assets that appreciate in value. I've talked a lot about assets in my video on net worth a while back, but as a quick recap, we'll define an asset as something that helps increase our net worth by either appreciating in value or generating income. Obviously, there's some overlap with our first item, but let's focus on assets that appreciate in value for this example. The most obvious example for good debt being used to buy assets that appreciate in value is investment property. For example, if you're in the business of flipping houses, you're really good at finding homes on the market that are either underpriced or they're homes you know you can fix up, sell, and turn a profit in a short time period, going into debt to purchase those homes would not necessarily be a bad thing. You would be using debt to purchase homes that increase in value and ultimately increase your net worth. Third, we have debt that saves you money by freeing up cash for investments. Now this one is a bit situational because I'm mostly talking about times where you've already taken some debt, but you've suddenly found yourself in a position to pay it off early. Maybe you've been saving money separately, not really paying down your debt. Maybe you get some sort of windfall. The point is, now that you can pay off your debt, should you? The interesting thing about this question is that with interest rates being where they've been over the last 15 to 20 years, I'd actually say that in most cases where the interest rate on your debt is low, you'd actually be better off not paying off your debts early. I've got a really good example of this that I'll cover a bit later. But for now, let's move on to classifying bad debts. Now that we know what good debts look like, how can we use that to better understand what a bad debt looks like? Well, it's actually pretty straightforward. Bad debt is one, debt that doesn't increase your income, two, debt for assets that depreciate in value, or in other words, debt for consumer goods, and three, debt that costs you money and negates any investments attempted. Much like the rules of thumb I gave for good debt, there's a lot of overlap in these rules, but let's dig into it a bit. First, we have debt that doesn't increase your income. Now, there's a lot of debt out there that doesn't increase your income, but I want to pick on that car example I gave earlier. I specifically mentioned that the car you buy should be a reasonably priced used car. It's a really important distinction because if, for example, you say, I need a car to get to work, that doesn't justify going out and financing a 2020 Range Rover for 100 grand. I would absolutely consider that to be some seriously bad debt. Having that Range Rover doesn't increase your income any more than a used 2018 Honda Civic would. So while you might be able to justify the cheaper car, you cannot justify a luxury or sports car by trying to say that it helps you generate more income. So debt that doesn't increase your income is one rule of thumb that applies to bad debt. Next, we have debt for assets that depreciate in value, or consumer goods. I'm going to go ahead and lump this in with our third item as well, the debt that costs you money or negates any investments that you attempt. There's countless examples out there of what this could be, so I won't spend too much time here. We're talking about things like furniture, electronics, jewelry. I mean, basically, if you can pull out your credit card and swipe to buy, it's most likely an asset that depreciates in value or some kind of consumer good. So we've covered the rules of thumb that can help you classify good debt and bad debt in general, but there's definitely some things that absolutely fall into each category, and some things that are a bit gray. Let's talk about the absolutes first. For good debt, I would say that you probably are doing good with any debt that you take for income-generating rental properties, income-generating investment properties, collector's items that appreciate in value, or profitable small business investments. For bad debt, you probably need to stay away from carrying balances on your credit card, payday loans, vacations you can't afford, overly expensive cars, and a whole plethora of other things. But what about the gray areas? See, in most of the articles I read in preparing for this video, there were three things that stuck out to me as not really making sense. First, we have student loans. These all appeared in the lists of good debt. Now, while I absolutely believe that education is a great thing and one of the most powerful investments you can possibly make in terms of making yourself marketable and employable, I don't believe that all education is reasonably priced. When you make any investment, you want to make sure that your return on that investment is a good one. It's a bit tough to define a set ratio of cost of a degree versus expected salary, but you can definitely get some directionally correct information to make a good decision. For example, I was curious, so I went and downloaded some data from the Bureau of Labor Statistics. The average educator with no experience and no training makes about $40,000 per year. So with that average income in mind, does it make sense to get your bachelor's degree in education from Stanford for about $312,000? What about Harvard? That one's only $304,000. It's just my opinion, but I honestly can't think of a situation where that makes any sense. Not when you can go to a school like University of Houston, go Cougs, and get the same degree for about $45,000. So when it comes to education and whether or not it's good debt or bad debt, I think it really depends on what you expect to spend versus what you expect to make. Next, we had homes. These always appear on the list of good debt, but again, I don't always think that a home constitutes as good debt. Similar to the car example I gave earlier, if you're going into debt for a reasonably priced home at a good interest rate in a good neighborhood that's generally appreciating in value, I would agree that your house is good debt. But if you go out and buy a super expensive home that you can't really afford, maybe at a bad interest rate, or maybe in a neighborhood that's not really doing so well and your home value is decreasing, this isn't good debt. So again, just something to consider when you're looking at your mortgage for your house. Finally, we had cars. These always appeared on the list of bad debt. Now, I've already talked about how they can be considered good debt if you need a simple car to generate income, but I've got another situation where it might make sense to have car debt. Let me show you. So what I've got here is a very simple calculation. On the left, I've got amortization, and on the right, I've got compound interest. So let's say you're in the middle of making your car payments. You've had a car note for a while, and you've just come into some money, and now you're wondering whether or not you should pay that car off or if you should do something else with the money. So let's say you owe $20,000 on that car. You've got that car at about a 4% interest rate on the loan, and you have about 25 payments left on that car. That means that you could stand to save around $800 in interest if you pay off the car today. So that's $800 you can save, okay? Let's say, for example, though, you took that same $20,000, invested it into an S&P index fund, and that got you a return of about 7%. The average is about 10 for the last 70 years, but let's be conservative and say 7. That means that you could stand to gain about $3,100 in the market if you invest that same $20,000 over 25 months. So this is a situation where I would say it definitely makes more sense not to pay off the car, and it makes more sense to just invest that extra money that you have into the market, because most likely it's going to be to your benefit. But again, it's important to do your best to try to stay out of bad debt as much as possible, but also to work towards getting a point to where you can take good debt if you want. If you want to get to that point, the best place to start is to have a good budget. So be sure and click on the playlist on the screen right now, because in those videos, I show you in depth how to create a budget spreadsheet from start to finish. Thanks for watching. We'll see you next time.